Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Project State and Its Rivals, a new history of the 20th and 21st centuries, by Charles S. Maier, narrated by Stephen Caffrey. Preface. This work arose as an effort to make sense of the political and economic transformations of our time. This can be a treacherous ambition. The historian's present is always changing, and at times, drastically. I was born a half year before World War II began in Europe. As a young but politically aware observer, I lived through episodes of the Cold War. Then, 40 years later, witnessed what seemed to be its sudden and surprising conclusion. Leave aside the digital revolution or the changes in medical science that have transformed all our lives, my adult lifetime has seen the vigorous post-war recovery of Germany and Japan, the peak of U.S. economic and international primacy, and the legal, if not socio-economic, dismantling of its racial hierarchies. In recent decades, the stupendous rise of Chinese national power, and even as I send this manuscript to press, in my 80s, the Russian effort to reconstitute the imperial hold it formerly exercised in Eastern Europe. This book, however, focuses on the developments that do not always spring to mind as constitutive of our times. I believe nation and territory and cultural specificities provide important coordinates for structuring historical narrative. But this book does not emphasize these markers. It is not a general survey of world history, nor a history of the nation-state and its conflicts, nor a story of celebrated and infamous leaders, important though they have been. It bypasses the military history of the great wars, the genocides, and the development of regimes that brought early death to perhaps 200 million people of the 11 billion or so who lived during a part or all of the 20th century. Instead, I have tried to illuminate other conflicts and forces that have successfully shaped, or perhaps more precisely, allowed the evolving political outcomes of the 20th century and the first quarter of the 21st. To this end, I propose collective protagonists that are different from the heroes and villains many histories follow. I focus first on project states, both democratic and totalitarian, with ambitious agendas for transforming political institutions, civil society, and even mentalities. Second, I examine resource empires, lingering formally until the 1960s, and thereafter bequeathing international legacies of racial and economic inequality that still remain powerful. Third, and fourth, the book discusses the transnational domains of capital and of the organizations supposedly devoted to disinterested governance. My account of the last 100-some years thus seeks to follow the evolution and changing weight of these four collective agents, sometimes working against each other, sometimes in tandem. This does not mean our old historical categories, such as democracies and dictatorships, are invalid or obsolete. This is hardly the case. But reframing long-term categories of historical analysis can provide a more comprehensive sense of the changes underway for a century or more. I have felt challenged, I must confess, by Montesquieu, who argued in the mid-18th century that the laws, by which he also meant institutions, had to be consistent with each other, that when one changed, all must change, and that their underlying relationship was what he called the spirit of the laws. I have tried to account for our new spirit of the laws. Are there lessons to be learned from this history? Can it be applied or provide us guidance for the present? My view of a historical work is that besides conveying information about the past, it should most importantly enlarge the world of the listener, somewhat as listening to a fine musical performance enhances the listener. It should provide an awareness of connectedness and difference, analogy, complexity, regularity, and contingency. Perhaps it makes listeners better able to confront the policy decisions they must face. Perhaps it instructively illuminates past short-sightedness, but it cannot predict which alternatives will yield success. As John Stuart Mill recognized in A System of Logic, it takes only one altered variable among many to make the present differ fundamentally from the past. Still, I do think there is a lesson that this perspective on the past can provide. It is that an active project state, an innovative economy, and disinterested governance need to remain in some balance. Without alternate sources of political agency, the project state alone can become abusive. Excessive rewards to capital will corrupt, and the prescriptions of rational governance alone remain feeble and often unaware of self-interest that may have motivated their prescriptions. The remnants of empire and the decay of republics suggest, I believe, that societies cannot sustain good government if inequality exceeds certain boundaries. But that belief is admittedly a political one, and what those boundaries are is difficult to say. I tend to believe that institutions of governance play a generally beneficial role and deserve the authority they claim, particularly in view of the climate change that challenges us all. Nonetheless, as my last chapter suggests, these claims of governance and expertise can produce their own backlash, and accommodating them in a democracy is a difficult task. In any case, if a listener wants guidance from the past outlined in this book, as well as an interpretation, these rather commonplace suggestions would be my offering. This work does not aspire to be an encompassing narrative of global developments since 1900 or even 1914. My own long-term research has centered on Western Europe and to a degree the United States, and I have focused on these areas at the expense, most likely, of doing justice to significant currents of thought and political aspirations that emanate from Latin America, Asia, and Africa. Moreover, while this book draws on my own historical reading and teaching for more than half a century, it does not claim to rest on direct immersion in the archives that exist for the countries and institutions discussed, even when I have the language capacity. It does cite primary sources at points where I have undertaken previous research, findings that went into specialized articles and essays, but it rests more on the monographic investigations of other scholars. To turn around the old statement about standing on the shoulders of giants, I, for one, see further because I stand on the shoulders of my graduate students, past and present, and other young researchers. In my citations, I have tried to privilege recent scholarship, which often productively revises and amplifies older classic accounts. Of course, I have read and can cite only a selection of all the works that have been produced on the developments under study. By and large, I do not cite general historical works that have provided narrative backgrounds, even though some are very valuable. I realize, as I end this book, that I am completing a series of works that have focused on the development of modern states. I never intended a trilogy, nor would I describe them as such. The earlier books, Leviathan 2.0, Inventing Modern Statehood, 2005, and Once Within Borders, Territories of Power, Wealth, and Belonging Since 1500, 2015, focused on the links between territory and statehood, while this current book attempts to analyze the state as one actor among other collective agents that shape political and economic developments. This should not imply that I have abandoned geopolitical concerns, but they are not the path to historical reconstruction chosen here. Still, many of the themes link up to my statement, consigning the 20th century to history, of the year 2000, and my first book, Recasting Bourgeois Europe, of almost a half century back. Perhaps like an old dog, I have dug up and gnawed on bones I forgot that I had buried. Still, in other ways, this book revises my earlier work. Implicitly, it subordinates many of my long-standing concerns with the legacies of Nazism, Italian fascism, and communism. I certainly do not want the concept of the project state to be read as erasing the difference between lawful democratic regimes and repressive governments, or the distinctions between left and right regimes from each other, as usually understood. Project states have served as a force for good and for evil. Some have aspired primarily to make their society more equitable, and others have sought to make their national power more fearsome. No one who has grown up in the 20th century or after can really confront them, devoid of their moral character. But social scientists and historians can still seek typologies that include experiences we find odious and those from which we draw inspiration. The spectrum of political outcomes suggested here also differs from what I envisaged at the end of Leviathan 2.0 7 years ago. But it would be a stubborn scholar who felt no need to revise his or her concepts over the course of time. And I have been enough of a non-scholar to want to explore new themes and subjects, perhaps at the cost of deepening my knowledge of previous ones. No doubt, were I to be in a position to revisit this work in, say, 10 or 20 years, I would think differently again. But that task will have to be left to younger listeners, including those students, colleagues, friends, and family to whom I am so indebted. Introduction. History's protagonists. Historians study change, but earlier histories of the last 100 years did not prepare us for the transformations around the world that have overtaken our politics and societies during the late 20th and early 21st century. Until recently, historical accounts centered on Europe and America focused on the long struggle between democratic ideologies and their authoritarian or totalitarian competitors, fascism and Nazism, conventionally classified on the right, and communism on the left. These developments seem to climax with democratic victories in 1945, or the remarkable collapse of the European communist regimes in 1989 through 1991, depending on the conflicts under scrutiny, whether World War II or the Cold War. For historians concerned with the populations that lived in Asia and Africa, the passage from colonial domination to independent statehood played a similar role in organizing a narrative of events that culminated between 1945 and the 1960s. Certainly, the second half of the 20th century was marked by brutal post-colonial and civil wars, a dangerous nuclear stalemate, and many dismaying reversions into dictatorship. Nonetheless, by the 1990s, repressive racial legal institutions in South Africa and the United States were dismantled, and many of the authoritarian regimes in Asia and Latin America and Europe had been democratized. Uphill battles, but an upbeat story. History, of course, did not end in 1989. The 1990s brought the destructive wars of Yugoslav secession and severe economic depression in Russia. The current century has been characterized by the most severe international economic crisis since the World Depression of the 1930s, by the rise of ethnic nationalist and racist movements, revealing traits familiar from interwar fascism, the murderous tenacity of religious zealots, the rise of would-be autocrats, and the plight of millions of unwanted refugees. Add to that the threat of trade wars, cyber disruptions, and renewed great power confrontation, a global epidemic, premonitions of environmental catastrophe, and just as this book goes to press, the cruel atavistic war in Ukraine. Among many of the laments in the last few years, several among many have stuck with me. First, the verdict of the respected British economic columnist Martin Wolf, who wrote somberly in late 2017 about the Great Recession. The West let its financial system run aground in a huge financial crisis. It has permanently underinvested in its future. In important cases, notably the U.S., it has allowed a yawning gulf to emerge between economic winners and the losers. Not least, it has let lies and hatred consume its politics. The daughter of a distinguished Italian political family, caught up in the early great conflicts of the mid-20th century, wrote toward 2020, "The history not only of Italy, but of all Europe and the entire world seems to have turned down a completely new road, different from those that have opened to us in the post-war decades. I do not know where this road will lead. There are numerous signs of danger and degradation. We have the sensation that catastrophe can emerge from within us, annulling humanity's consciousness of the need to respect others and of the will to imagine a future and to construct it." More recently, David Brooks, the conservatively inclined commentator for the New York Times, sought an explanation for why history is reverting toward barbarism. And he asked, "What is the key factor that has made the 21st century so dark, regressive, and dangerous?" The question that has engaged me in this book is related but different. How to write a history of the 20th century and the years to date of the 21st that can account both for the success of liberal democracy some three decades ago and the dark, regressive, and dangerous developments since then. Major syntheses have wrestled with the legacy of a dark and violent path. The vicissitudes of post-war recovery, beset by traumatic collective memory, and the tensions of overarching ideological conflict. Others have stressed the long road toward welfare, prosperity, and emancipation. I do not believe that history is necessarily a story of progress toward liberal democracy or greater equality. We cannot know whether the decades will take us further into the dark or reverse course again. But can we narrate the story until now as more than an unending contest between Democrats and authoritarians, with successive rounds going toward one contender or another. And if those obvious ideological opponents are not our main focus, which protagonist should be? My answer is set out in the following. How did we get here? A history for our era. Two approaches to the history of the past century have predominated until recently. For writers who have remained focused on 1933, 1945, or 1989, dominant inquiries have usually sought to explain the conditions under which democracy thrives or decays, or conversely, when authoritarian regimes arise or collapse. Eric Hobsbawm's celebrated Age of Extremes followed these vicissitudes from the left. Samuel Huntington and Francis Fukuyama drew political typologies from a conservative perspective. Given the great ideological struggles of the 20th century, most historians have seen the era since the 18th century revolutions as an epic contest between democratic and authoritarian, even totalitarian, regimes. For historians on the left, progress has entailed overcoming accumulated hierarchy based on wealth, race, and gender, on privilege based on birth, and unjustified authority. Conservatives, in contrast, have argued that the underlying peril arose from democratic overreach. They warn that societies have heedlessly destroyed institutions that may have accommodated inequalities, but provided organic social roots and shelter. I have earlier termed these historical accounts moral narratives. They were organized, or at least justified, in terms of the great principles at stake. That term was not meant to diminish their significance. The contests at their center were indeed fundamental, as all the great intellectuals of the era recognized. They claimed the passions, liberties, and lives of participants. We still rightly worry about dangers to liberal democracy at home and abroad. But there are other ways to think about the history of the last 100 years than as a contest between democracies and dictatorships, emancipation and oppression, fascists and communists, or even just between liberals and conservatives, left and right, or moderates and the ideologically obsessed. Many historians, mostly of a younger generation and on the left, who have sought to explain developments since 1989, have in fact shifted focus from the confrontation of democracy and authoritarianism. They are transfixed by the power of capital, the advance of globalization, at least until the past decade, and the success of neoliberalism. That is, by trends that reduce the role of states as the preeminent agents of world history in favor of the economically powerful. Such a focus helps make sense for the year since 1989 and, as I argued 20 years ago, since the changes of the 1970s. That decade marked a point of inflection between a century-long global regime from the 1860s into the 1970s that seemed clearly organized around territorial states, their commerce, conflicts, and ideologies, and the era in which we have found ourselves since. Although we still divide the world into nation-states, contemporary developmental forces seem increasingly to cross their boundaries and leave territorial orientations behind. The state is not disappearing, but its function is a far denser milieu of influences. The process has been far from uniform, however. How can we best comprehend both the order of states and the transnational developments that sweep the globe? The approach in this work is to identify and follow basic historical protagonists that have operated over the course of the past century, both when states loomed as decisive actors and when they appeared overshadowed by other agents. My protagonists are collective actors who possess different sources of power and public influence and seek to maximize their historical roles. Four such agents of transformation have seemed particularly important to me. Two are based on the potential for exploiting territorial organized political authority: the Project State and the Resource Empire. Two draw upon sources of influence that cut across territorial jurisdictions, what I term the realm or community of governance, based on normative aspirations and the web or domain of capital, consisting of individuals and firms working to secure and increase economic returns. These four agents are not the only possible protagonists, but together they carry the weight of a lot of history. Critics may well object that the different and sometimes opposed actors within each of these historical forces, ambitious leaders, political parties, business enterprises, foundations, non-governmental organizations, NGOs, and so forth, outweigh whatever abstract unity they might have possessed or unified influence they exerted. Whether they do or not must remain a subjective determination in each case, but I try to take account of internal distinctions. Conversely, those who are interested in the history of political economy, as I myself have been, usually take as a working premise that capital and the state cannot really be disentangled. But although they are usually found in interdependent relationships, they can be distinguished analytically like threads in a tapestry, and I believe it is fruitful to do so. Let me emphasize that none of the four collective agents deployed here has operated in isolation. Each has joined forces with one or more of the others, but they vary in their impact, and their changing power and importance determine, or at least reveal, many of the developments and events of history as experienced. The history that follows is thus based on the evolving interactions between varieties of territorial rule and forms of non-territorial power. It does not wager on any particular future for confirmation, but tries to provide a framework that makes progressive as well as regressive outcomes plausible. Its aim, moreover, is not just to write a history of current crises and conflicts, although it hopes to illuminate them. Primarily, it seeks to explain the long-term stresses inherent in early institutional arrangements, like the structural flaws in a bridge or building that suddenly collapses after we were convinced it was totally robust. History constantly surprises, but the job of the historian is to make it seem less surprising. The Project State and the Resource Empire. With respect to the territorial protagonists, two major themes occupy this history. The first is the rise and eclipse. Final or not, no one can say. This history must remain unresolved. Of what I term the activist Project State. The Project State was a political unit that consciously aspired to inflect the course of history. If large enough, it wanted to play a leading and perhaps hegemonic role in international society. No matter what its size and power, it aspired to change social and economic relations in a profound way, and not just to prolong administrative continuity. Project States had a transformative agenda. They were based on authoritarian, or even totalitarian, as well as liberal and democratic coalitions, seeking to reform sclerotic institutions or societies that seemed unacceptably unequal. In addressing the societies they proposed to reform, they organized their recruitment of personnel and legitimation of rule around ideologies, grand historical narratives that served Project State maintenance. By and large, the diagnoses and projects envisioned one of two approaches. Call them left and right. Either they beheld a society flawed by historic legal and material inequalities that needed to be rectified, whether by revolution or redistribution, or they perceived a national community deficient in family, ethnic, or other organic bonds, invertebrate, to cite José Ortega de Gasset's phrase for Spain, which had, in one way or another, to be disciplined. The project state, as used in this book, differs from other regimes that political scientists have often evoked, such as the developmental state and, earlier, the administrative state. The developmental state stood out by its active guidance of economic modernization. The administrative state was an older concept designed to emphasize the functional specialization of governing agencies. It often suggested a suffocating bureaucratization, such as conveyed by Max Weber's metaphor of the iron cage. How to control it democratically seemed the major problem. The project state, in contrast, supposedly sought to energize the citizenry, even if its leaders often settled for mere acclamation. The project state was often just a phase of longer-term government, since the fervor demanded could rarely be sustained beyond a few years or a decade at most. Leaders, however, would occasionally try to whip up enthusiasm for a renewed phase of civic mobilization, sometimes with a search for enemies or mere slackers. No hard and fast line sets the project state apart, but it entails a degree of self-aware ambition. Its leaders set an agenda they understand as going far beyond ordinary administration, whether in terms of social change or state authority. They sense a historical calling. The projects are described at greater length in the following, but they include significant extension of social services and welfare, raising the level of national education, and mobilizing a civic or revolutionary and national consciousness. Reflect briefly on the idea of the project itself, an individual or collaborative enterprise that is carefully planned to achieve a particular aim, according to the Oxford English Dictionary, a word derived from the Greek to look forward. Wikipedia gives the Manhattan Project, the Apollo Program, the Human Genome Project, and the Great Pyramid of ancient Egypt as examples. This history associates the project with a public communal effort, but in the 20th and 21st centuries, private enterprises assumed public dimensions and can excite the public imagination. Henry Ford's River Rogue Auto Plant early in the last century. Today, perhaps Elon Musk's SpaceX. Certainly, state projects have an ambiguous historical record. They have mobilized societies, or those speaking in their name, to construct the Tennessee Valley Authority on one hand and Auschwitz on the other hand. Social theorists on the left have argued that this peril is inherent in the nature of capitalist modernity. Economist magazine editors and many far more doctrinaire commentators tend to believe that the danger arises from the nature of the state and believe that when anchored in a market society, the project remains benevolent. American projects have usually been associated with either the visionary entrepreneur or the analogy of war. For example, the war on poverty, the war on terror, the war on cancer. Results are mixed. Our public health projects, mass vaccination campaigns for polio, and today, COVID-19, for instance, have been technologically impressive, but have faced difficulties arising from poverty, our racial history, and a polarized polity. Achieving transcendent security at home and sometimes abroad could become a project in its own right, above all because the project state often saw itself as embattled, and indeed often was. At recurrent moments, its architects felt themselves standing at Armageddon. Some of the opposed forces were impersonal legacies of poverty and dependence. But for pathological rulers and parties, opposition took the form of alleged mortal conspiracies of class, race, or faith. Project states were sometimes founded by ambitious politicians, but also emanated from military cadres who seized power in the conviction that civilian rulers were decadent, corrupt, or leftist, and that only patriotic and selfless armed forces could regenerate the nation. The idea of a project state raises analytical and ethical problems, and I want to recognize their difficulties. When project states were powerful international units, they tended to define their aspirations in universalist terms. They aspired to make a world hospitable for their values, whether expressed in terms of a superior civilization, race, or ideological merit. National projects easily became imperial projects, and project states have often been in a situation of conflict with each other, of cold, if not hot, war. The inverse relationship also holds. War makes states, and it makes project states in particular. If this book is examined in a time of war, the state will seem a more important protagonist than if it is listened to in an interval of peace. The concept of a project state raises another difficulty as an analytical tool, to me, the weightiest. Should activist regimes that do not systematically violate human rights really be seen as akin in any way to those that practice political violence and coercion as a major technique for molding society? Should not the distinction between regimes that seek to preserve individual liberty and dignity, even if riddled with pockets of injustice, and those that trample on them, whether at home or abroad, remain the fundamental distinction in making sense of our epoch's political history? Can the historian justifiably suspend this moral categorization in trying to make the past intelligible? Most public commentators have doubled down on the fundamental difference between authoritarian and liberal states. Does it not remain the primal distinction of our time? And is it not just sophistry to obscure it? I would certainly not erase the distinction as a guide to political action. Most historians of the United States, whether yay-saying or critical, would also have resisted. So, too, would some of the great European historical thinkers, such as Jules Michelet and Karl Marx, as would, in particular, historians of Nazism and Stalinism, and a theorist such as Hannah Arendt. History, for them, remained a moral drama. Niccolò Machiavelli and Max Weber, on the other hand, derived important insights from such a suspension of moral criteria. More recently, Charles Tilly notably insisted that the sine qua non of force lay behind government as it did behind gangs. Some, such as Alexis de Tocqueville, could retain their moral commitment but still perceive the institutional similarities. This work proposes a pragmatic response. It is not intended to equate project states, but it argues that looking beyond the distinction between liberal democratic and authoritarian, even totalitarian regimes, helps reveal the dynamics of recent history. And it can also compel us to think more clearly about the defects of our own political systems. Project states were usually creatures of war, revolution, or profound national crisis. For some countries, China, Turkey, and Mexico, their transformative regimes emerged from the revolutions that had shaken their societies in the decade before World War I. Russia had undergone a wave of revolution and counter-revolution after 1905. These significant upheavals were compressed, and at times, armed efforts to shatter semi-feudal rural hierarchies and clientelist politics, which had also provided for an outsized role for foreign interests. But even in non-revolutionary situations, advocates of the project state envisaged the creation of a new society that transcended traditionalist loyalties oriented toward the family, church, or military, but were rather to be based on enhanced civic consciousness. The great interwar depression of the 1930s prompted the reemergence of an American project state, albeit bitterly contested, with the New Deal. Democratically oriented projects were resumed with the defeat of fascism in World War II and continued into the 1960s. Most of these struggles were carried on by the institutional form that dominated the history of the last 200 years, the organized political party, either a new one or one of long-standing, energized by domestic crisis. Organized parties with professional staffs and subsisting between elections justifiably drew the attention of political theorists and sociologists throughout the 20th century. Whether single or many, they dominated the history of regimes the world over, though often to atrophy in energy and vitality. The party, in turn, sometimes emerged from a political movement, a mix of spontaneous upheaval and carefully cultivated enthusiasm and anger, not yet institutionalized into the governmental apparatus. Movements might erupt during moments of economic discontent or resentment at political exclusion, volcanoes of history that broke through the crust of routine, sometimes to generate project states, often ultimately to congeal anew within a ritualized arrangement for exercising power. My major interest has been the states they helped transform more than the movements themselves. But as in the most recent eruption, labeled as populism, discussed in Chapter 10, regime and movement can be hard to disentangle. Thinkers as diverse as Michel Foucault and James Scott have suggested that, in effect, all states must be project states. They want to enumerate, make legible, and rationalize their subjects. Examining religious as well as political institutions from the late Middle Ages, Foucault introduced the ideas of governmentality and biopolitics to describe a state agenda for molding populations. But there are different degrees of intervention, and states can vary in their activism, asserting a role in war and crisis that becomes routine over time. The difference in intensity, I believe, justifies the special category, even when historians dispute whether the label is usefully applied to one or another case. In fact, all the major belligerents in the world wars had to become project states temporarily, to the degree that they intervened to harness their populations to the overriding objective of national survival. The wars compelled participants to coordinate economies and societies to an unprecedented and ever more pervasive degree. But although many of the belligerents undertook this effort for the duration, they also dismantled controls once peace was secured. We are examining the regimes that undertook or attempted major intervention in peacetime. Not all states, of course, were project states. Many were content to penetrate less deeply if too much unrest did not threaten the political regime. Project states often involved an unleashing of violence that could exhaust populations and was hard to sustain beyond a decade or two. Some societies, usually thought of as liberal, resisted this recourse, at least at home and in their national politics, though allowing it in colonies or the enforcement of segregation or ethnic cleansing in unofficial capacities. Other states governed through layers of familiar elites, especially when they had the additional task of ruling a far-flung and ethnically diverse empire. Finally, the project state itself seemed to lose its momentum by the 1970s. Other less collective objectives took over, and the great historical movement of the project state, at least in the West, faltered in dilution. Until yesterday, at least, European and American societies were living through a phase of its abandonment and rejection. Whether it is reviving at the present moment is yet to be determined. The other territorially defined form of rule this book follows is a variant of imperial control I term the resource empire, which is discussed in Chapter 2. Empires are forms of state, but the idea of a state, or a nation-state, implies formally equality with other sovereign polities, often as signified by membership in international associations. Empires claim superiority of one sort or another over other peoples or political units who do not yet have sovereignty. The resource empires were certainly not the only form of imperial control, but they represented the effort to enjoy the fruits of overseas colonies that had already been conquered before World War I, or were gained as a prize of victory in 1918 to 1919 from other colonial powers. Resource empires were less structures of restless territorial acquisition, interwar Japan and Italy's efforts exempted, than of extraction. Hopefully, though rarely in fact, cash cows for beneficiaries in the metropole or settlers in place. The League of Nations helped inscribe a new, largely racially or ethnically based status quo that envisaged indefinite tutelage through the mandate system. The elusive standards of civilization, or readiness for self-rule, remained powerful normative justifications. The winding up of the resource empires followed during the quarter century after World War II. But if the formal empires ended, the one-time colonies often continued to furnish material resources and labor power for their former rulers. The resource empire demands our attention, not only for its history as such, but as a source of ongoing relationships of economic inequality, privilege and power of the global North, and continuing disadvantage for the global South. There were many reasons. The stigmas of racial difference did not bleach out. The cultural resources of the old metropole continued to exert their magnetism over post-colonial elites. Metropolitan firms relied on their plantation products, fruits, vegetable oils, and fibers, and on the minerals that local laborers dug out of their mines, and most important in an age of expanding energy needs, on their petroleum resources. The contests over what might be called petro-empires remained important through the third quarter of the 20th century. More generally, the economic fortunes among nations and regions in a globalized world have remained significantly unequal, as the descriptors Third World or Global South imply. Inequalities of wealth and economic autonomy have prolonged a twilight afterlife for the resource empire. Domains of governance and capital. Operating alongside and often within states and resource empires were organizations and networks that aspired not to sovereign power, but to moral and political influence and/or to material gain. They might have headquarters based within territorial states, but they increasingly functioned within international or transnational domains defined here as the domains of governance and of capital, both discussed in Chapter 3. We can use varying terms: domain, realm, community, space, field, web. They all refer metaphorically to networks of decentralized participants that mobilized public opinion and finance, often across national lines. Think of them as creating something like a gravitational or magnetic field in physics, filling international space with invisible lines of energy or influence. The term governance has surged in popularity since the 1980s. Today, it often means just the procedures and usages according to which non-political organizations are managed. Rules governing behavior where the coercive capacity that states possess does not apply, but it can carry more specific implications, which are those relevant for this account. The realm of governance I refer to here includes the non-state or interstate organizations that propose to intervene in society by invoking ethical, normative, or expert considerations, whether supported by laws and governments or not. The dense development of international law and courts constitutes a major part. Transnational health provision provides another. In the 18th century, the Republic of Letters might have been seen as having an analogous role. In the 19th and early 20th centuries, the idea of public opinion summoned up some of the same ideas. These organizations operated both within state borders and in international space. Historians used to regard the international domain as the passive arena for contending national foreign policy ambitions, but many today increasingly argue that the international or transnational arena is a space that in effect shapes its own normative practices. To resort to another metaphor from physics, if the life of states was bound together by the strong forces of alliances and interests, the realm of governance constituted the weak force of transnational opinion. whereas the rules that states imposed might be decreed by a single actor, whether individual or cohesive party, the norms of governance usually emerged from a collective deliberation. Participants in that process sought to discern and enact public goods that politics or markets do not always provide. An end to civil violence, human rights, honest government, access to education, better medical care, and environmental preservation. But by promoting reforms for states and firms, actors in the realm of governance also prolong the continuity of resource empires and sometimes the hegemony of powerful states. The champions of governance claim the self-evidence of norms, just as American colonists once declared the self-evidence of rights. The claim of governance had a long history well before the term became widely used in the 1980s. Combating global inequality would eventually become a major goal of the United Nations agencies and NGOs. But advocates of international governance long sought to negotiate compromises between the reformist ideas championed by pre-1914 international liberalism and the aspirations of conservatives to uphold or even restore what they believed to be the status quo of a peacefully accepted inequality of peoples and races. The World Depression of the 1930s undermined the conditions that allowed these reformist projects to prosper. Instead, it increased the assertiveness of project states, weakened the authority of resource empires, and ripped apart the international realm of governance by the end of the decade. The realm of governance was reconstituted after 1945 and seemed to increase in vigor, but its success depended on its partnerships with the web of capital and ambitious states. After World War II, as chapters 4 and 7 discuss, the role of organizations claiming to advance governance became increasingly problematic. Some clung to humanitarian ends, others seconded and even aspired to form their own government's political and economic goals, convinced that they were advancing objectively humane values even as they required the resources of their home nations and economic systems to prevail. The line between norms and interests became very wobbly, as interests were advanced as rights. The phenomenon of think tanks revealed that party and economic interests could adopt the prestigious form of the foundation to sponsor a partisan agenda. The analyst of global politics is left to ask whether claims of governance did not really become just a discursive strategy for a new would-be elite, unable or unwilling to see the interests they were serving, whether others or their own. The concluding chapter suggests, in fact, that ambitious leaders and many voters in the 21st century have mobilized against the pretensions of governance communities. The web of capital has included the individuals and organizations, firms, banks, trade associations that participated in markets where they reciprocally exchanged goods, labor, real property, and promises of future payments in a framework supposedly free of legal or extra-legal compulsions. Capitalism, as an institution, however, involves more than the role of markets for organizing economic life. It is a system of production and of exchange dependent on money equivalence, that is, upon a common and preferably stable measurement of value, a numeraire, to allow exchanges of all sorts of commodities, labor, and natural resources beyond direct barter. Non-state owners retain the ownership of much, if not all, property. Its production model usually entails small groups of managers or employers directing a large number of workers and receiving a higher income for doing so. Although it is often taken for granted, capitalism incorporates a role for time and duration in establishing how much goods and labor are worth. It presupposes that at the end of cycles of production and exchange, the values attributed to the economy should normally be greater than at the beginning. Something marketable has been added, whether by dint of physical labor or mental effort, extraction from nature, technological change, or heightened desirability. How that precisely occurs has often been puzzling. Marx believed that ultimately it must derive from labor, but how it was put into the stream of capital was part of the reproduction problem with which he continually wrestled. If attributed to firms, the additional value is designated as profit. If attributed to society as a whole, we talk about economic growth. Marxists, in particular, use the term accumulation in part to signal their ideological affiliation with each other. Of course, how this increase, or in some cases decrease, should be distributed is a question of politics. For capitalism is also characterized by a particular relationship to political systems. It frequently relies on the state for investing in technological innovation. It certainly relies on the state to protect those who control economic assets from theft, abusive practices, and sometimes disastrous losses. It relies on the state again to set essential parameters, such as key interest rates and a budget for public expenditures, assuming it does so in the interests of capital and growth. And at the same time, capitalism needs a state that allows firms and individuals to accumulate assets with monetary value and regulates the legal framework for the economic process. Thus, although there are many exceptions, 20th century capitalism evolved toward what was called a mixed economy in which private ownership, contracts, and profit remained critical. Despite many historians' treatment of capitalism as an all-encompassing causal framework, my own view is that the political system, based on the resources of power, whether accumulated by force or consent, remains conceptually independent. Thus, this book is not a history of capitalism, though it includes the agents in that system as key actors in historical change as a whole. These agents include very different forms of activity. On the one hand, entrepreneurs and firms who produce and sell manufactures or commodities. On the other hand, those who extend the credit, insurance, and legal services that facilitate their activity. Their respective policy interests have often been in opposition to each other, but they remain entangled in the process of wealth creation in market societies. Characteristic of the interaction of state and the agents of capital in the modern era, and the 20th and 21st centuries in particular, was the decision vastly to increase the money claims available in any current time period against promises of future redemption. The demands of war constituted one motive. Social conflict and welfare commitments also led to this expedient. So too did the central insight of financial firms that promising future gains could generate private wealth in the present. No society can truly tap wealth that has not yet been created, any more than it can create labor or soldiers from the yet unborn. But it can encourage mobilization of innovations, resources, techniques, and potential that lie fallow in the present, a process we describe as economic growth. In doing so, it multiplies claims on future payments that have present value and can produce massive transfers of wealth, whether intended or not. Sorting out these claims has constituted an agonizing theme of recent history. The Great Wars, in particular, contributed to this outcome. National debts multiplied, and were increased too, by the claims enforced by the victors in peace settlements and from national credits extended in aid programs. As a result, the high-level participants in the web of capital became important through the 1920s, both as leaders of profit-seeking firms and experts in allegedly restoring an international financial order. As such, they were also participants in the web of governance. The custodians of capital failed, however, to assure continued global prosperity between the wars for multiple reasons. Above all, as they tried to reconcile the overhanging burden of international debt and reparations with their single-minded focus on international currency stability. They also seemed powerless to maintain the income of the world's agricultural producers and protect them against widespread poverty. Following World War II, these actors constructed a more stable fabric within the U.S.-led Bretton Woods order. Experts and firms pursued different roles. Multinational firms claimed a larger role. By the 1970s, they captured a lot of alarmed attention, and today they hover as superficially decentralized entities cited in an economic space where their global reach often evades the regulation states can deploy. In the contemporary digital era, moreover, the technologies that they provide for an almost universal consumer public, notably the social media and increasingly non-state money, have provided incentives to free themselves from political control and even from the weaker reins of governance. The very nature of capital, moreover, continually evolves and becomes increasingly immaterial, liberated from its traditional sources of natural endowments, control of labor, and accumulation of savings, arising finally from the belief in its own continued increase. This confluence of efforts indicates the fact that each of the collective actors presented here, Project State, Resource Empire, Realm of Governance, and Web of Capital, could hardly subsist on its own. They were discernible forces contending for power, norms, and wealth, but not independently effective. The agents for each required the cooperative efforts of the others, even when they were rivals for influence and power. Their personnel often overlapped. In wartime, above all, the state sought step by step to incorporate economic actors into its acknowledged scope for setting goals and priorities. As studies of war production show, it met less outright resistance than inertia, and its own internal bureaucratic rivalries. The networks of governance often serve state purposes and often aspire to serve states. They lent states the respectability of soft power, to borrow Joseph Nye's felicitous term. But their agendas transcended raison d'etre. They also increasingly required the collaboration of economic and financial institutions. States, on their part, required economic viability. There was no firm line in the 20th century between capital and resource empire, nor did the leaders associated with the realm of governance really divorce themselves from the objectives of capital. It remains an open question whether many important institutions should be classified as within only domain or another, say, capital or governance. Yet, for all the braiding together of objectives, programs, and personnel, we can usefully understand the circumstances of recent history by trying to trace each strand on its own, understanding, however, that as if in some spreadsheet of history, any change in one of these variables produced changes in the others. Other historians might suggest different protagonists as fundamental. What about the domain of religion, it needs to be asked, whether faith or institutional practice? Certainly, it continues to play a critical role in the world of states and popular movements, whether in the Islamic mobilization, so crucial to history in the Middle East, or in evangelical movements that have come to weigh so heavily on politics in the Americas. Listeners may object to my subordination of religion as the prejudice of a secular intellectual. But insofar as religious commitments motivate political action, whether in Iran, Israel, Poland, the United States, Myanmar, or so many other places, I have considered them as a motivation for a variant of Project State. I do not mean to disparage the religious convictions that motivate these currents, but their activism in this world seems keyed to making state projects prevail. What, too, about the working classes, the proletariat, so crucial for Marxists? My scheme envisages labor as a component of the realm of capital when it does not exercise decisive political power, and as a force behind the project state when it does. Alternative histories are possible. But given the desire to understand our current conditions, the collective agents I will work with seem promising. The listener can decide whether they help sort out the developments of the last 100 years. To anticipate the developments narrated here, project states outside Asia reveal an ambiguous trajectory after the 1960s. From one perspective, they failed to generate convincing public agendas. They seemed increasingly just to serve the classes that had access to the skills of a digital economy, mass entertainment, or political office itself. Their leaders increasingly retreated from political management of society and turned to markets to achieve social results. But from an alternative point of view, this great transformation amounted to an alternative state project in its own right. Margaret Thatcher and Ronald Reagan, to take the most salient leaders, deployed tremendous political energy to transform the states they ruled and to liberate the market economy. By the 1990s, even the leaders of the opposition left parties became cheerleaders for largely untethered capital under the slogan of market democracy. Resource empires were to disappear as major actors, but the opportunities for neo-imperial transfers of wealth hardly disappeared. Instead, they were transmuted not into some enduring post-imperial commonwealth, but into capital assets. These were sometimes independent, but often ventures such as jointly held oil firms, still controlled by former imperial rulers or by the new post-colonial states. In the successive phases of rapid technological change after the two world wars, first, the modernization of industry and agriculture, and then the digital revolution, capitalist firms seized the opportunity to metastasize into the domains of national politics and transnational governance. Chapters 5 and 6 will wrestle with these changes. It is the realm of governance that is perhaps the hardest to describe or to populate in ordinary terms. Its international role was apparent from before World War I and grew between the wars. Emerging within late communist regimes under the rubric of civil society, or elsewhere as international and non-profit organizations, it could stand up to state power, but it withstood less effectively the transformed technologies and financial possibilities of the 1990s and after. The collapse of the Communist Party regimes also contributed to this result, as private firms or new post-Soviet oligarchs captured once socialized assets. With states hollowed, the energies of governance largely neutralized, or even arousing a populist resistance of their own, and capital largely amenable to whatever government allows it to prosper, the personalist regimes we have encountered in recent years, whether in the United States from 2017 until 2021, and still today in Brazil, Turkey, India, Hungary, and elsewhere, captured the blighted institutional landscape, both territorial and transnational. To be clear, I am not trying to personify these abstractions. Men and women manage states, exploit imperial acquisitions, accumulate wealth, and try to discern and shape community values. These protagonists are not even ideal types intended to clarify real existing phenomena. They are not institutions in the sense of bounded organizations. Historians often take refuge in the notion of deeper or underlying causes, but that is not really what is at stake either. I am not claiming casual primacy for interests or ideals or ingrained allegiances. Rather, this history tries to follow some dominant efforts to secure collective aspirations, whether for national communities, economic organizations, or selected public goods. The contemporary historian's present is always a cloud of possibilities. How are the agents of history traced in this work likely to develop? Will capital remain the dominant transnational force as structures of governance focus their energies on limiting state abuses, climate change, or fighting medical and social catastrophes? Great corporations depend on territorial states even as they seek to emancipate themselves from the constraints and levies of state control. But the state is hardly finished. In dozens or hundreds of contexts, it is fighting back, seeking to capture revenues generated by international firms, trying to bridle or nationalize the new information channels that are curated by global information providers. States are strengthened in times of international conflict. At the same time, however, the state is also symbiotically entwined with the providers of capital and technology, and the outcome may be, as it has often before, a condominium of the powerful, private, and public. The chapters that follow document the unfolding of these developments. For the moment, therefore, the new spirit of the laws in Western Europe and America, to take Montesquieu's concept of the institutional gestalt that I cited earlier, has produced an institutional result far from what so many Europeans and Americans aspired to in 1989. The order that has emerged is puzzling in many ways. It is not simply counter-revolutionary in the way that we might describe the suppression of the Arab Spring. It followed from the triumph of many of the principles and aspirations of 1989. It has not been the result of a simple increase in global inequality. For whereas inequality has increased within Western societies, many of the poorer world societies have become wealthier, above all, China. It is, in fact, not order in the way theorists such as Samuel Huntington or Francis Fukuyama or Henry Kissinger would have used the word, but a potentially explosive impasse of conflicting privileges and resentments. Order, of course, is the pervasive trope of conservatives who fear that the accustomed hierarchies of the world are losing their legitimacy. Those who tend to invoke it usually want to defend political arrangements that favor and reassure those already enjoying influence or wealth. But if it does not mean uncontested hierarchies within societies and the absence of war between them, it is not easy to specify wherein it consists. Disorder is a more palpable condition. As we confront the turmoil of the refugee crisis in the Mediterranean, the toll taken by Mexican and Latin American drug gangs, the partisan rage and disregard of fact in U.S. politics, the uncertain state of the European Union, the mushrooming of a transnational billionaire elite and of untethered corporations, the viral spread of social media, the intensity of religious militancy, the enthusiasm for authoritarian leaders appealing to ethnic identities at the expense of state institutions, much of the globe seems to be undergoing a surge of hostility to the order that seemed to prevail until the current century. China presents the major exception, but whether it too might fall into disorder, as it has periodically over the last three millennia, is impossible to predict. Must a history, however, that sees a transformation of a global system dating from the 1970s view the earlier post-war years in a rosy hue as a period of socio-political equilibrium or order? I would reject this implication. The post-war balance of forces contained many repressive elements in politics, the workplace, family and emotional life, organized religion, aesthetic possibilities, and of course in terms of race and gender. Is any period, even one of apparent stability, it can be asked more fundamentally, ever really an era of equilibrium or order? The term can lead us astray. Political equilibrium is not a condition of repose, but rather one of countervailing tensions that is rarely prolonged in time. What follows is a history of the changing balance among the protagonists of the 20th century and the first decades of the 21st, each one embodied in an institutional arrangement. The long-term prospects seem up for grabs, especially at the current moment. Written histories have an endpoint. For this one, it is the present. But history, as the life and struggles of humanity goes on through time. Perhaps in retrospect, this will seem a history that could have been conceived only in a moment of democratic disillusion. Perhaps it will read as a testament to a brief interval when the distinction between liberal and authoritarian states gave the misleading illusion of weakening. Perhaps, if we are fortunate, it will seem an alarmist account negated by later events. Every contemporary history is a provisional stocktaking, and lived history is defined by its surprises. No doubt there will be further surprises and new understandings. Part 1. The Era of World Wars. 1. Paths to the Project State. One of the great monuments constructed in the wake of World War I does not rise above the battlefields of the Western Front, or in fact, above any of the far-flung sites of combat. Neither does it shelter the remains of a soldier known only to God in a marble sarcophagus or beneath an eternal flame in a national capital. It is a series of about 100 volumes on the economic and social history of the World War, commissioned by the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, and comprising studies by national teams of historians. Published during the two decades after the war, the investigations examine the organization of increasingly militant factory workers, the evolution of hospitals and medicine, the impact of economic blockade, the changing age profiles of populations after so many males from ages 20 to 45 had perished, the production of munitions, the allocation of scarce shipping and food and textiles, the shock to state finances, the mortality of children and of the aged in the face of food shortages and disease, the relaxation of sexual inhibitions, and the growing sense that despite all the efforts of state planning, life was becoming a lottery. Some of the monographs still stand as landmark studies by notable social scientists. G.D. H. Cole's report on British Works Councils, Luigi Einaudi's summary of Italian wartime finance, David Mitrani's study of the quasi-feudal subjugation of the Romanian peasant, and Albrecht Mendelssohn Bartholdy's Reflections on the Mentality of Wartime Germany from his 1930s Yale Refuge, among others. Significant studies also followed the Second War, but no equivalent internationally coordinated series of investigations emerged. The Carnegie Endowment's history remains a testimony to the Project State whose emergence it was intended to record. What it was and was not. The authors who got to work after 1918 understood that state and society had become intertwined in an unprecedented effort during the huge struggle just ended. State agencies had allocated raw materials, rationed food, organized producer cartels, coordinated shipping, given official representation to labor delegates in factories, and established prenatal care, among other interventions. They endeavored to sustain the morale needed to accept the continuing conscription of hundreds of thousands of young men every year, many of whom were mangled or swiftly perished. Wartime governments, in sum, had to organize society to help it survive the most arduous of ordeals. The Great War lay at the most recent origin of the 20th century Project State, a term I use to specify a regime that seeks not merely to govern day to day, but to transform the non-political institutions of society, economic outcomes, public health, religious commitments and secular loyalties, landscapes and cityscapes. It allowed fantasies of radical malleability. President Woodrow Wilson and his supporters entered the World War in 1917, promised a war to transcend war, institute democracy, and establish an organization for perpetual peace. The German Supreme Command envisaged the virtual conscription of industrial labor at home under the Hindenburg Plan. And by 1917 to 1918, the British and French were not far behind. At the same time, the General Staff commanded fighting a war deep into Russian imperial territories, entertained proposals for transformation of the Polish, Baltic, and White Russian provinces that would subjugate the allegedly backward indigenous Slavic peasantry, clear out what they beheld as parasitic Jewish traders and their dirty shtetls, settle German farmers, and guarantee agrarian independence. Defeat in 1918 drove these plans underground, but they and some of their advocates remained to energize a new National Socialist leadership. So, too, defeat in the war frustrated the Young Turks' ambitions for military and political and economic modernization of the Ottoman Empire, if not their genocidal population policies. But it also left a remnant of military reformers under Mustafa Kemal, later Ataturk, to institute a state project in Anatolia that would reclaim Turkey from Greece and British occupying forces by 1922. The war, too, gave the Bolshevik leadership their chance to seize a decisive foothold during 1917 as the Imperial Russian armies wearied and decomposed on the front, while political leaders in revolutionary St. Petersburg proved unable to control popular aspirations for peace and land. The ending of the war thus fused hopes for military organization with utopian notions of reclaiming a purified society. Societal transformation was a project too daunting and too divisive to be left to civilians alone. The project state would always retain a military and competitive component. The demands of the World War were not the only stimulus for the 20th century project state. Revolutionary movements outside Europe had set about constructing new regimes that aspired to profound transformation. A half century earlier, the most ambitious rulers of Japan's territorial domains set out to renovate their country and preempt subjection by Western powers. They laid the foundation for an East Asia project state. The first decades of the 20th century brought a wave of revolutionary upheavals that shook Russia, Mexico, China, Iran, and the Ottoman Empire. All large societies, still preponderantly agrarian, but deeply impacted by the industrial and imperialist powers. Some began as limited middle-class efforts to transfer power from a ruling clique to a parliament or to military reformers. But they could not always control activist, peasant, and urban labor movements, mobilized by intellectuals who aspired to create modern regimes that would oust a governing elite allegedly corrupted by foreign wealth. The project states that revolutions brought to power usually depended on the role of a single party that could exploit political collapse. As a party that resolutely aggravated social dislocation and crises in Russia from 1905 to 1914, Then, after 1917, and through the upheaval of collectivization after 1928, the Bolsheviks provided the most spectacular example. Elsewhere, military cadres, imbued with a sense that they must redeem their nation from foreign exploitation or civilian corruption, could also provide the nucleus of a project state. Mustafa Kemal's Turkey, Chiang Kai-shek's nationalist movement based in Nanjing, and certainly its Communist Party rival and successor after 1949. Egypt's free officers who removed King Farouk in 1952 and the old regime associated with him, or the clerics who unseated the Shah in 1978 and subdued their initial leftist allies, are important examples. In most of these cases, whether based on party or soldiers, transformative authority tended to concentrate increasingly on a personal leader to whom heroic capacities could be attributed. The results were and remain ambiguous, as was the case in Republican China after 1911. The new regimes could become afflicted by corruption, warlord rivalries, and foreign invasion. Their policies could also impose disastrous costs on their population, as in the Soviet Union, or the rhetoric of transformation might outrun the accomplishments, as was the case in fascist Italy. Ideological programs can be traced to fervent beginnings in the decades before World War I. Radical parties in Europe, whether conventionally labeled as left or right, had elaborated fundamental critiques of liberal politics. Vladimir Lenin's 1902 pamphlet, What is to be Done, made the case for a dedicated revolutionary cadre that must ruthlessly guide the large and exploited but unfocused proletariat. Nationalist and authoritarian thinkers, among them Action Française ideologue Charles Maurras and the spokesman for syndicalist militancy Georges Sorel, were contemptuous of parliamentary debate and praised violence as regenerative. Maurras's young adherents took to splashy and aggressive demonstrations. The reality of war a few years later suggested to many more participants that the role of unquestioned command and the exercise of violence were recourses for survival. The level of commitment to political activity required by the project state, whether forged in war or revolution, would remain hard to sustain. Sometimes, when ideological energies seemed to flag, organizers doubled down on the cathartic value of radical violence. Joseph Goebbels would call for total war in 1943. Mao Tse-Jung would unleash cultural revolution in 1966 to 1967. More benign transformative experiments, the German Revolution of 1918 to 1919, the American New Deal, the French Popular Front, the British Labour Government of 1945, also envisioned project states, but they aroused a hostile and debilitating opposition. The radical energies of the project state surged and then abated, sometimes achieving significant institutional change, but also leaving stagnation, disappointment, and melancholy. The episodes remain, however, as the most dramatic feature of the past century's vicissitudes, the Himalayas of 20th century history. Listeners are entitled to pose some hard questions. In what sense might it be said that the project state was anything new? After all, the 17th century Puritan saints, certainly the French Jacobins, and most new regimes and groups of rulers who had taken power in revolutionary times possessed the same fervor for political transformation. Do they count? Yes. Along with other revolutionary upheavals, including Haiti, they kindled transformative hopes, but they usually aimed at overturning old repressive legal institutions rather than building a more encompassing state, even if they ended by imposing even greater degrees of constraint. Arguably, the Napoleonic regime in France and the wartime organization of the U.S. federal government during the Civil War could be described as project states, and both bequeathed precedents and institutions for more stateness. All historical phenomena can be shown to have precedence. As a continuing and non-exceptional form of polity, however, the project state came into its own in the 20th century. It still remained difficult in the 19th century to harness the indigenous resources to institute what might count as a project state. Many charismatic and talented leaders in Africa, Latin America, and South Asia might organize formidable military polities that subjugated neighboring lands for a decade or two, but could not institutionalize the fiscal and bureaucratic institutions to construct durable states. Some leaders attempted to launch a thoroughgoing reform program, but collided with the persistent realities of clientelist politics and insufficient material resources. The Middle East and Latin America proved to be a graveyard for project states. Sometimes outside imperial powers aborted local programs lest they lose their own domination of a region. Muhammad Ali, who possessed the skill and ambition to build a project state in Egypt during the early 19th century, collided with the British and French protectors of an Ottoman Empire they deemed more compliant and serviceable for their own ambitions. Iranian reformers in the late 19th century remained squeezed between rival British and Russian desires to preserve a feeble monarchy as buffer for their respective neighboring empires. In East Asia, as noted, the Japanese successfully created a project state, but clearly limited democratic dimensions for the sake of military, industrial, and bureaucratic modernization. The would-be modernizers of the Qing Empire in the late 19th century ran up against not merely the conservatives of a faction-ridden imperial court, but countervailing European and Japanese programs for imperial domination of their woefully armed and industrialized society. Would-be revolutionaries in Cuba and the Philippines collided with American policies, which remained in favor of their achieving independence from their Spanish rulers, but not autonomy from their U.S. patrons. One reason was that the American proconsuls in the overseas territories that had been occupied since 1898 believed that they should be preparing new project states themselves, not in their own continental territory, but in the transoceanic periphery. As elsewhere, military planners would remain enthusiasts for societal intervention, an early version of nation-building. Denying simple imperialist objectives, Americans, the most celebrated perhaps, physician and Colonel Leonard Wood, envisaged combinations of liberation, hygiene, and institution-building, such as police, in areas that had languished under Spanish plantation rule. The causes of progressive reform at home, then of liberating Europe from German militarism from 1914 to 1918, then later overcoming the Great Depression, would bring this crusading impulse home to the North American continent. The Japanese, who accumulated their own transoceanic periphery in Taiwan, Korea, and other outposts in Shandong and the Liaodong Peninsula, Dalian, Darien, entertained analogous imperialist projects, although under more ruthless military auspices. Why, to address a further issue, should not the results of national unification and territorial centralization in the mid-19th century count as project states? The statesmen who unified Italy and Germany in the preceding century had taken on a strenuous political mission, but creating a state as a project is not the same as constructing a project state. For a Cavour or Bismarck, the effort was to magnify the states they steered, Savoy and Prussia, as armatures of larger national structures. For the intellectuals, the political mission presupposed that a national people already existed with some degree of self-awareness, and it sought to provide them with viable institutions in a competitive world, or to overcome civil strife, we the people, to form a more perfect union. The project state, on the other hand, was the work of leaders who often felt they had to form or re-inspire a people. The society they took in hand, so they believed, had not yet really come into being as a cohesive whole, or it had once existed and then fallen into corruption or banality, or it had become demoralized, or it had been taken over by evil agents. The project state was redemptive. Not all eventual leaders of project states started out by conceiving so ambitious a mission. Many, including civilians such as Franklin Roosevelt, had participated in military or administrative service during the World War. Some wanted only to hold office, solve a temporary crisis, get people back to work, or eliminate corruption and foreign influence. But to resolve the defects, they found their agenda inexorably grew more encompassing. Finally, consider the question that the author has asked himself throughout: whether project states can be clearly distinguished as a subset of states in general. A major strand of contemporary social science claims that to see like a state, to think in terms of governability, or to make societies legible through classification and statistics makes all states effectively into project states, potentially repressive, if not totalitarian. I disagree. The borders of the concept may be fuzzy, but the project state strives to reshape society and not just to control it. Admittedly, the ambition to acquire or retain power can itself become an objective that requires, as 18th and 19th century liberals understood, subverting intermediate bodies or the forces of civil society. It could also lead to expansion abroad. Statehood in the international area might entail the assertion of dominance over other states, or over peoples presumed to lack states and history. Political scientists have used concepts similar to the project state for analysis of diverse regimes, but distinctions are important. The project state, as pointed out in the introduction, refers to a governing enterprise that was different from what some have called the developmental state. Development, or what social scientists a half century ago liked to term modernization, was of course one sort of project. Leaders such as Chiang Kai-shek or Mustafa Kemal Ataturk wanted their countries to be modern in the sense that Europe or America was supposedly modern, that is, possessing industry, programs for public hygiene, and secular education. But project states could already have achieved a high level of economic and institutional development, as indeed many of those in interwar Europe had already done. The project state was not just a large state as measured, say, by the share of national income it collected, redistributed in social spending, or devoted to public works and the military. In Western Europe, the public sector share of national income distributed through the state, largely to military expenses, interest payments on the public debt, education, and infrastructure, surged in World War I and II, then fell back. But it has grown from roughly 8 to 15% before 1914 to 40 to 55% today. Almost all governments in today's developed world have taken charge of programs for public health and transport, advanced education, and the like. Most of these programs have become familiar and expected. Neither is the project state necessarily what political scientists have termed a strong state. That designation usually is meant to suggest that the state can successfully make extensive demands on society, that it can penetrate pre-existing institutions, whether political, familial, or religious, and can collect revenues and mobilize citizens in public causes. Certainly, the project state aspired to these capacities, but it did not necessarily achieve them. It is a term used here to suggest ambition and program, but not always accomplishment. Benito Mussolini's Fascist Man, or Sun Yat-sen and Chiang Kai-shek's New Life, remained rhetorical aspirations. Case histories and general patterns. Some project states have appeared as relatively brief phenomenon. They were historical stages of ongoing polities, the solar flares of regimes that burst into heated activity during crises and then burned out or settled back into ordinary historical continuity when leadership changed. Others renewed their energy over several decades and successive waves of upheaval. Mexico's initial uprising of diverse political leaders and clienteles against longtime strongman Porfirio Diaz soon dissolved into civil war between regionally based militias with varying ambitions and programs. General Alvaro Obregón managed to impose a stable regime in 1920, before being assassinated in 1928, like several of his predecessors. But it took another decade or so to firm up the new regime under the aptly named Institutional Revolutionary Party, PRI. Even then, by the 1930s, there would follow violent clashes with the Cristeros, a movement of armed protest against anti-clerical policies, and a renewed conflict with the British owners of the nationalized petroleum industry, until finally, by the late 1930s, President Lázaro Cárdenas consolidated a one-party democratic settlement. Acceptance of state discipline by a revolutionary peasantry that was now benefiting from extensive communalization of land, the ejido, was critical to the outcome. Along with the Bolshevik experiment in Russia, but a far more scattered and diverse set of activists, China provided the hugest arena for reformers and revolutionaries seeking to construct a project state. as armed revolts against the dynasty broke out in many cities in the fall of 1911, the common theme was despair with the court, whose emperor and advisors were seeking to roll back the reforms that more enlightened officials had started to launch in the last decade. The last-ditch effort by the Manchu court and officials triggered an ethnic as well as political upheaval. Out of the Manchu disintegration, two centers of republican institutions emerged: the National Assembly in Beijing and the Military Revolutionary Party that would become the Kuomintang, KMT, in Nanjing and seize control between 1927 and 1931. From the perspective of the post-World War II communist triumph, the accomplishments of the Republic, 1911 to 1949, have often seemed feckless, condemned by corruption, and by Chiang Kai-shek's authoritarianism. But the agenda was ambitious. The Republican parliamentary regime, based in Beijing, witnessed the mass demonstrations of the May 4, 1919 movement, then settled into a succession of short-lived rivals, overshadowed by provincial warlords nearby. In the South, under the tutelage of the Third International's agent, Michael Borodin, Sun Yat-sen, and then Jiang articulated their own state vision and modeled their KMT party state on the Bolshevik example. Joseph Stalin miscalculated, however, in urging the local Communist Party to continue collaboration with Jiang's KMT. Once KMT loyalists had seized Nanjing in 1927, the party turned ruthlessly on its communist adherents in a mass purge dramatically memorialized in André Malraux's novel, Man's Fate. Establishing a capital in Nanjing was the founding act of a decade of transformation that would culminate in the Northern Expedition to take Beijing by 1931. It also opened the party to a process of transformismo, in which opportunist warlords, bureaucrats intent on securing a future as officials and favored private businessmen, rushed to join. Young radicals and intellectuals produced blueprints supposedly based on the broad principles that the ideological patriarch Sun Yat-sen had enunciated in exile. As, however, a recent author has argued, suppression of political activism accompanied careful, choreographed expressions of civic enthusiasm. Deploying the political machinery of a radical revolutionary party, the GMD, Kuomintang, KMT, embraced revolutionary capitalism, but rejected Western materialism and imperialism. It sought an ethno-communal solution to China's semi-colonial status. In light of Chiang's devastating defeat in the Civil War, 1945 to 1949, and the far more radical transformations that followed the victory of Mao Zedong's People's Republic, it was easy to denigrate the nationalist achievement. The Cold War stakes of the debate for American politics, with the McCarthyite attack on U.S. advisors for undercutting Jiang, influenced the effort to show how Jiang's vanity and stubbornness bore responsibility for his collapse. The wartime and post-1945 calculations appeared comparable to how later rueful American critics viewed the sad final act of the South Vietnamese government, 1973 to 1975, or the recent collapse of the Afghan regime once Washington removed its forces, 2021. In that light, can the Nanjing Republic really be counted, therefore, as a project state? Indeed, according to Jiang himself and other qualified observers, the revolution had failed by the early 1930s. KMT goals, along with politics in Beijing, remained most intent on checking potential rivals for leadership. But it also faced extraordinary challenges. It sought to claim a nation geographically fragmented, beset by inundations, global depression, and Japanese invasion. Agricultural prices declined by about half between the late 1920s and mid-1930s. From 1929 to 1931-1932, China's adherence to a soft money silver standard favored investment and peasant debtors. But once Britain and the United States left the gold standard, that advantage was erased, and foreign investment dried up as well. The U.S. Silver Purchase Act, passed at the behest of Western mining states, resulted in silver being drained from China's reserves, and the foreign capital that was made available had to be devoted to recovery from the serious flooding of the Yangtze River in 1931 that displaced over 25 million people. Perhaps it would be most accurate to say that the Chinese national regime that established its capital in Nanjing until the Japanese invasion of 1937 sought to control a turbulent mobilization of projects to build an effective and modern state. The effort partook of the same energies and aspirations as other project states. There was no single model of national strengthening, but rival domestic programs marked many of the activist governments of the 1930s, whether the New Deal, the Soviet Union, or the Third Reich. Jiang worked for a militarized national state, and the affinities of his program to European fascist movements has remained at the center of historical debate. Its nationalism, authoritarianism, and in its depiction of the Chinese nation as a victimized collective proletariat echoed themes redolent in Italian and post-war German nationalism. Productivist ideology was also influential. Song Soo-bun, who had family connections with Jiang, came the closest to a financial technocrat and business spokesman within the regime, and lasted the longest. He worked the hardest to treat finances and the economy as an autonomous force and pressed for the organization of a national economic council influenced by corporatist ideas. Jiang, preeminently concerned with military unification of the remaining warlord territories, managed to clip the wings of the new council that debuted in 1931, placing it under the executive department he headed. Funding, dependent on American loans, destined for recovery from the disastrous 1931 floods. Given the Japanese pressure after 1931, including the attacks on Shanghai, the council managed to emerge as a critical agency and collaborate with the other strand of nationalist reformism, the peasant-based corporatist project proposed by Wang Jingwei and his collaborators, who entered the KMT government in the mid-1930s after earlier left-wing flirtation. Increasing the productive powers of the countryside and increasing its purchasing power, Wang held would facilitate national industrialization. He sought to combine earlier reformist ideas for an autarkic peasant-based economy, inspired by Sun Yat-sen, with Italian corporativist ideas. Wang originally followed Chiang to the KMT wartime capital in inland Chongqing, but returned to head a collaborationist Republic of China in Nanking under Japanese occupation. Only his death in Japan in 1944 spared him a post-war treason trial and probable execution. Wang's trajectory paralleled that of the French labor corporatists who threw in their lot with Vichy, and he was labeled a Chinese Viet Cung Quisling. The reality is that under conditions of foreign occupation, no program of state-organized labor organization could be evaluated in the abstract without taking into consideration its role in the great and cruel wartime struggle, and none could be imposed without repression. In Europe, by the spring of 1919, the European states that had entered the war or undertaken mass revolution seemed to be on the verge of durable transformations. Some were strengthened, some shattered. Many were in the grip of revolution and civil war, or bloody struggles over boundaries. The sprawling Tsarist Empire had decomposed and was stripped of its Western possessions by its adversaries in early 1918. Then, by emerging national units, successor claimants to East Central European territory continued to wage brutal ragtag warfare for several years in an effort to determine which intermingled ethnic group would belong to which new political unit. Inside the Russian heartland, Bolsheviks asserted precarious control, but were assailed on all sides by counter-revolutionary and Western coalitions. The Habsburg possessions were seized by national claimants, who embarked on brave efforts at democratic statehood, but were mistrustful of each other while their economic exchanges withered. The German Reich, which had counted on its military and industrial organization to prevail, faced humiliating defeat and a continuing blockade as radicalized soldiers and workers claimed revolutionary authority in its largest cities. Demonstrations suppressed by right-wing veterans' units seethed in Berlin, the Ruhr, and Munich. The new Republican regime soon had to assent to territorial losses and an undefined stream of payments to the victors. The countries that had prevailed, Britain, France, even Italy, all supported by the United States, unscathed across the ocean, could celebrate victory, but had fought out bitter disputes over war aims and had lost up to 10% of their young men. Even as the toughened leaders who had led the Allies to victory had asserted a new social and economic discipline, the potential for industrial discontent grew and was to be asserted through 1919 in massive strikes and demonstrations. The victors' colonial subjects were also restive and demanded the new self-government and democracy that they believed had been promised by Woodrow Wilson's visionary addresses. Claimants for self-rule or the militant advocates of a new socialist international sparked agitation in the cities of South Asia, Africa, and the Middle East, only to learn that the promises might be granted at best in a distant future. Their delegations would return disappointed from the Great Peace Conference in Paris. Nonetheless, many in the metropoles, as well as in the colonies, believed that a new social and political order was to emerge from the war. A new beginning, and the chance for a league of peace. Returning veterans, politically aroused intellectuals, the hard-bitten revolutionaries, and those merely trying to take up the severed ends of family life, all made their claims on what briefly seemed an open and malleable future. The Project State emerged from crisis, but not all crises yielded successful Project States. Some countries soldiered onward with politics as usual. Others responded unsuccessfully. Not all the states and political elites that improvised interventionist regimes during the war wished to maintain a high degree of state involvement in the economy and society once peace returned. The war separated those who wished to preserve the exaltation, heroism, and collective bonding they derived or remembered from the war, from the mass of workers, businessmen, women and families, and a new generation who wanted to move on with family and occupational life. In some cases, through the 1920s, regimes remained divided between parties that had social democratic agendas, as in Weimar Germany and Republican Austria, and their long-term political adversaries who wished to establish citizenship based on traditionalist structures, church, or military. U.S. leaders called for a return to normalcy. Let business and families resume their familiar lives. Others, we cannot quantify them, but their clamor compensated for their probably small numbers, could not demobilize psychologically. If soldiers, they missed the remembered camaraderie of army life. If civilians, they may have missed the sense of collective purpose and dedication the war could evoke. Some felt committed to the level of central regulation and state authority that the wartime project had entailed. They emerged addicted to the transformative agendas, whether socialist on the left or nationalist on the right. The state should continue to serve not merely as an administrative entity or a historical given, but as an instrument by which bureaucratic reformers or zealous partisans could mold a plastic national society. Revolutionary upheaval or economic crisis, or even the paralysis of parliamentary decision-making could unleash this energy needed to prevent a relapse into pre-war politics. Over the post-war decade, however, national societies constructed a set of institutions, some democratic, others authoritarian, that seemed to promise an accepted and relatively stable result. By the mid-1920s, workaday electoral politics brought conservatives and centrists to power in Britain, France, Germany, the Low Countries, Scandinavia, and North America. Behind the unrest, stability in Western Europe was achieved less through electoral politics than by implicit social compact, as industrial leaders and those long-time working-class representatives who shied from radical action reached consensus on centrist policies that provided advances in social policy and a free hand for entrepreneurs and property. Industrial leaders negotiated cartel agreements across national borders to stabilize markets within the prospect of moderate growth. But this convergence of political centers still left some older cleavages to fester, such as those of religion and education. Neither could they conclusively remove the grievances left by the peace settlements of 1918 to 1919. Whether the overhanging reparations issues or the new contested boundaries of East Central Europe, here were continuing opportunities for demagogues. National economies seemed to recover after bankers confirmed, willingly or not, by means of radical currency depreciation on the European continent, that perhaps half the European household savings accumulated as of 1914 had been liquidated in the Great War. Inflation could be good for business and tolerable for organized workers, even as it operated as a confiscatory tax on the middle class's bank accounts, war bonds, and life insurance policies. States and firms could shed the debts they owed at home, but critical to the business recovery was the fact that private American loans through the mid and late 1920s promised to make the European debts across borders, including projected German reparations, and across the ocean to U.S. taxpayers and investors, far less of an impediment to renewing commerce and industry. Stabilization of post-war capitalism meant the future was less plastic than it had appeared. For many, this meant relief and progress. Democratic regimes had been achieved in much of Central Europe, but for others, whether Western or colonial revolutionaries, setback and defeat, even as they preserved party and labor organizations to keep their aspirations alive. Many of the latter were to be imprisoned, beaten, or killed. And in some of European societies, new authoritarian regimes would treat their liberal opponents at home with a violence that the powers victorious in the Great War applied only to their colonial subjects, or in the United States, to racial minorities. Liberal democracy and a hardcore Bolshevik effort to seize power in post-war Hungary had been the first to succumb to authoritarian military and civilians. It would collapse in stages in Italy before an innovative unleashing of a movement based on nationalism and violence tolerated by bourgeois elites who wanted to roll back working-class assertiveness. The King of Spain installed a military dictator, and the officer corps in Poland decided that the new republic had to be placed under their control. The example encouraged generals in Argentina and elsewhere in Latin America to seize power anew. Admirals and generals played a continuing and constitutionally inscribed role in governing Japan, although they seemed prepared to let civilian politicians play at running the country. Other signs of trouble included the staging of political conflict in the streets, whether in Paris over the collapse of the franc in 1926, the British general strike of 1926, or the acquittal of violent right-wing political demonstrators in Vienna in 1927, which led angry socialist protesters to torch the Austrian Supreme Court. As the advent of fascism had demonstrated in Italy from 1919 to 1922, reprising 19th-century revolutionary demonstrations and the 1915 rallies by those pressing to enter the World War, the public staging of politics, with the violence it easily generated, always had the potential to escape the restraints of constitutional procedures. Politics as theater, that is, rowdy demonstrations, had become endemic in the decade before 1914 and was an even more tempting recourse after the World War. Indeed, what seemed to matter across the urban centers of the world was often less everyday politics than performative, akin to the new edgy cultural developments prefigured in the creative decade before 1914, but becoming a frequent recourse in post-war streets and factories. The really profound innovations in science and music and painting had burst upon the world, it seemed, in a few years, around 1905. But their mass resonance followed in the post-war. Through the cinema, the new jazz coming from America, the modern styles, whether for austere housing blocks or opulent Art Deco buildings, the bolder gender behavior of young women and men, the mass athletics, daring airplane flights, and the growing pervasiveness of automobile traffic, urban societies, whether in New York, Paris, Berlin, Moscow, Shanghai, or Tokyo, seemed to detach itself even more than before the war from its rural hinterlands. Those left to stagnate, or even perhaps to thrive in the provinces, resented the metropolitan centers of supposed decadence. They could demonstrate that they would not let customary status or values, patriarchal, religious, or racial, be diminished without a backlash. In the United States, the crusade for prohibition, the revival of the Ku Klux Klan, the shutdown of mass immigration, and the reluctance to allow the teaching of evolution in school curricula testified to the fractures of a society that had briefly engaged with the wider world of international politics and felt betrayed by the experience. By the early 1930s, global economic crisis threw all the recently renegotiated socioeconomic settlements into question. Depressed agricultural prices and growing unemployment, which soon overwhelmed new and underfunded unemployment insurance funds, radicalized the electorates of Central Europe, where voting still mattered. Mass migrations from the afflicted regions to the Americas, formerly so important a valve for development and social stability, was no longer an option once the United States established national quotas for immigrants in 1924. Peasants and farmers around the world had suffered through 5 years or more of stagnation, poverty, and growing indebtedness. Agricultural distress proved the most persistent and pervasive problem, whether in economies that had substantially reduced farming, examples Britain and Belgium, to less than 10% of its labor force, those that kept a substantial agricultural sector in being, the United States, Canada, and Germany, at around 25%, and those where it engaged from a third to half the families of the country, France, Scandinavia, and the less developed world. Farm prices had crashed in the Depression, and in some cases weakened significantly before. Global politics was still hostage to the hardships faced by peasants and farmers the world over. The anguish of farmers and peasants was like a huge millstone dragging on the global economy between the wars. Farmers could not be fired, but they could be foreclosed. Prices for their commodities could fall far more proportionately than those of industrial goods. Growing single crops for markets, they and their families could suffer malnutrition and subsist in a countryside only partially electrified, and, as in the case of the Dust Bowl, economically degraded. In China, devastating floods in 1931 worsened their misery. In the Soviet Union, the confrontation with a regime that fundamentally distrusted the rural masses who had taken over landlord and village holdings after 1917 produced divergent policy recommendations from the mid-1920s on. Stalin exploited the disagreements within the Communist Party to ally with and then denounce their respective advocates. By the end of the 1920s, he opted for a fierce policy to collectivize peasant holdings, enforced by trials and deportations of those farmers who resisted, and the denial of food imports into a Ukraine in the throes of famine. How many millions of country folks' lives have been sacrificed by remote elites under the spell of doctrine? Whether collectivist convictions in the case of communist Russia and China from the late 1920s to the end of the 1950s, or dogmas of market rationality in the case of British administrators in Ireland a century before, and in India in 1943. Soviet advocates of a less drastic agricultural policy in the 1920s, such as Nikolai Bukharin, paid with their lives during the purges of the next decade. The world economic and financial crisis of the 1930s spread distress to industry as well, and now compelled the would-be architects of global stabilization to address economic arrangements alongside the political ones. The prevailing orthodoxy of global austerity, cutting wages and government expenditures, only aggravated the distress. The resource empires enjoyed some cushion to allow feckless deflationary policies to continue at home, although even they were forced into some unprecedented monetary devaluation of their currencies in terms of external standards, the pound against gold and the dollar in 1931, the dollar against gold in 1933, the French franc repeatedly from the mid-1930s, the Japanese yen from the mid-1930s. Advocates of these adjustments had to argue against those who resisted, and their policies tended to fight real contraction less through the hoped-for revival of exports than the accompanying fall of interest rates at home, which allowed an uptick in business investment or new housing. Ultimately, so Keynesians maintained, it took fiscal, not monetary policies, including deficit spending, if need be, to get beyond the painful years of depression, and it took preparation for wars to justify much of the new spending. The result was a decade of needless misery on a global scale for those afflicted, to be matched in individual countries only with the collapse of the Soviet Union in the 1990s, or briefer crises in emerging market economies around the turn of the current century, or in the southern periphery of the European Union from 2008 for another wasted decade. Amid the economic wreckage of the 1930s, political innovation beckoned urgently. Church and local welfare no longer sufficed to cushion poverty. States would have to prop up agricultural markets with national marketing boards to stabilize supply and prices. Neither was it enough to combat family misery with direct aid. Capitalism was in disrepair and called out for new institutions for structuring competition. Canada, Australia, Sweden, and ultimately the United States and France sought salvation with new coalitions among economic interventionists. In the shadow of Germany's new Nazi government, Central Europe turned toward militarist and authoritarian governments. The project state that reemerged in this agitated period would characterize regimes otherwise bitterly opposed to each other over the next half century. Its advocates believed that political institutions should and could decisively reshape civil society. Civil society associations, economies, aesthetic expression, the family, and the physical environment, and even individual mentalities. Its leaders and civil servants were confident that politics should not just preserve ways of life, but also transform them. To govern was not merely a question of winning mass support, holding office, and applying the rule of party and/or the rule of law, although the capacity to decisively exercise power was a prerequisite. To rule was a redemptive vocation. Some forms of redemption sounded more threatening than others. Creating the fascist man who would live as a lion and not as a jackal was a different project than raising out of poverty one-third of a nation ill-housed, ill-clad, ill-nourished. Mussolini called for the former. Franklin Roosevelt strived for the latter, even as Roosevelt's project exalted democracy's mission in quasi-religious tones. Leaders and labor. The project state, whether on the left or the right, required and nurtured a special relationship between its leaders and a mass public. Leader became a highly charged term, obviously, for fascism, where Il Duce and the Führer became the ordinary, and, in Germany, the legal title. But also in the Soviet Union, where the early debate over whether the term Vossit should be attributed to the party or to an individual was resolved in favor of the latter, as Stalin consolidated his power from 1924 to 1929. By the 1930s, there were many nakaldiki, or heads in factories, departments, and so forth, but only one vost, or leader. Contemporary American usage, with all its books on leadership in business and other activities, has made the term a relatively functional attribute, devoid of mystique. But through the earlier 20th century, the leader and leadership retained an almost mystical aura of authority. The leader's lieutenants took satisfaction in being led. As necessary as the rapport felt between the leader and the individual, though that was important, was the performative appeal that the leader had to exert over a crowd assembled to listen, sometimes in a stadium or square, sometimes over the new medium of radio. Even for democratic leaders, acclamation by the crowd, or what commenters called with approval on the left and concern on the right, the masses remained a resource for governing. In the pre-war decade, conservative commentators described the masses as a dangerous encroaching mob responding to instinctual collective impulses. Vilfredo Pareto, Gustav Le Bon, and many others envisaged these dark crowds much as Francisco Goya had depicted their superstitious village predecessors in his nightmarish paintings of Romeros, or pilgrimages, a century earlier. The masses emerged as a term in social democratic and socialist discourse before World War I, as these parties planned to mobilize the political resources of collective action, including the mass strike, to force political change. Educated observers beheld this rapport ambiguously. Did it not awaken archaic collective impulses? Critical liberals tended to ascribe the enthusiasm of mass crowds to a dangerous pre-conscious response, as did Thomas Mann in his 1930 allegory of fascism, Mario and the Magician. From the end of the 19th century on, these impulses were rediscovered as a challenging problem, but potentially a political resource. as Francisco Campos, an advisor to Brazilian dictator Getúlio Vargas and admirer of fascism, declared.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.